Welcome to our 2016 Call for Discernment Conference. It's entitled The Cross or the Crescent and a Biblical Understanding of Islam. And so you guys make yourselves at home. If you need anything, we've got food out there. There are drinks on the table. Help yourself. Take breaks when you need to. And at this point in time, well, let me remind you, we've got bathrooms. If you don't know, I think everybody here does. Bathrooms off to the your left over there. We've got the kitchen over here if you need anything out of the fridge. So help yourself. And at this point, let me just say, too, as we're getting started, thank you to all those who are serving. Really, really grateful. We've got a lot of people that are actively working and serving so that we can enjoy this conference, enjoy our time together, and learn a lot. So we're very grateful for them. All right, well, let's get started. Tonight's session is an introduction to Islam. And I've been asked, and maybe you've asked the question, or been asked the question yourself, why do we do conferences like this one? You know, why are we doing a conference on Islam? Dealing with pressing issues like this. We did a conference last year on homosexuality. We've got one coming up on the sanctity of life. Why do we do conferences like this? Well, one of the reasons we do that is because these issues are pressing issues. They're issues that are in the forefront of our consciousness. Every day, you turn on the TV, you listen to the news, you read articles, you open Al Mohler's briefing, you're going to see articles, information on Islam and how Islam is impacting our world today. You're confronted with what this world sees as competing ideologies. And one of the loudest voices, one of the most confusing voices, one of the most perplexing voices often today is this squeaky wheel, if you will, noisy voice, loud voice of Islam. Now, the world's answers to this problem, and this, the world's answers to these voices that we hear, is hopeless, is empty, it's inadequate, shrouded in blindness. Many don't have an answer for Islam, and they grope around in a dark room looking for light, any light that they can find, while at the same time, they're suppressing in their unrighteousness the one light they have. But Christians have the answer. This is where the church comes in. It's where the church must come in. And we as the church have been given a responsibility. We've been given a great commission. The church is the pillar and ground of the truth, and we as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ are to hold forth the word of life in our generation, and certainly to those that are enslaved and lost in Islam. So God's word has a lot to say about the issues of our day. And rather than avoid those issues, or rather than neglect those issues in our negligence or in our silence, we want to shed light on those issues. We want to expose them as the unfruitful works of darkness that they are. And we want to deal with them biblically, deal with them faithfully, and then press into that darkness with the truth. So we don't want to avoid subjects or issues like Islam. We want to address them. We want to confront them with the truth of God's word. God's word has much to say about the error that is Islam. Christians should have a voice and a lot to say about the error that is Islam. And so we have a responsibility in that. Apart from a conference like this, it's difficult, isn't it, to find opportunities to spend a considerable amount of time and work through an issue like this, an issue like Islam. And so this conference gives us an opportunity to do that. So what I want to do is just spend a couple of days breaking this apart, looking at specific practices, looking at specific theologies to help us understand this so that we can, in an informed way and in a compassionate way, talk to people who are trapped in that or address this issue of Islam. That doesn't happen here only at the conference. It happens between conferences, right? Happens between messages or between classes. And so what I hope that you'll do over the next couple of days as you take thorough notes, I hope copious notes, as you really think through the theology involved, the practices involved, that you'll be able to take that instruction, let that sink in, and think through how you can address Islam, the problems that we see in Islam, the problems with their theology, so that you can bolster your witness. It's going to bolster your love for Christ. It's going to bolster your love for His word in contrast to Islam and the Quran, but also so that you can be a bold witness for Christ. So to sum all that up, to get started, why do we host a conference like this? One, we host a conference like this for God's glory. The truth of God should be proclaimed in the face of error. And so that's part of what we're doing here. And that's what the church will do going away from something like this, proclaim truth in the face of error. Secondly, for the good of the saints, for their instruction, for their edification, for their bold witness. So it's for the good of the saints. And thirdly, it's for people trapped in darkness. We routinely, I know we have several folks that witness out of the campus. We're out there every week, and more out at UCF are running into Muslim students who don't know anything about Christianity, and frankly, many of them don't know anything about Islam. And so this gives us an opportunity to be able to reach them. So by the grace and mercy of God, through the means of the gospel, Muslims might be delivered from darkness and shown the light, conveyed into the kingdom of the Son of His love. So our hope then for this conference, for the time that we're going to spend over the next few days, with God's blessing, with God's help, it's going to be to equip you, to encourage you, and to exhort you. All right, first, we want to equip you. So over the next couple of days, we want to become familiar with Islam. Islam, in many respects, is a lifelong pursuit. We'll talk about that more as we go. But you can have, leaving tonight, can have a good, solid foundation for what Islam believes and what they practice, right? We want to equip you over the next couple of days. You're not going to know it all, but you'll know enough to get you started. None of us up here that will be speaking is an expert on Islam, but we're going to give you enough to help you as much as it has helped us, and we want you to be informed. So we're going to scratch the surface over the next couple of days, but hopefully it'll be a helpful couple of days. If you're evangelizing and you spend some time engaging with Muslim people, then over the years, as you're evangelizing, this kind of information or this kind of foundation is going to take root. And the Lord is a means of grace to you. You're going to learn more and more about what they believe, more and more how to answer and face their objections. You're just going to become more and more useful and more effective in your witness for Christ as you witness to Muslims and as you learn these things, as you put more of them into practice. So take lots of notes. You've got a conference folder, right? So in your conference folder, if you flip through that, a lot of good information in here. Got the agenda on the first page. But as you flip through, you'll see notes pages like this. You've got a notes page for the introduction. We're going to fill that up tonight, hopefully. But take notes. I'm going to try to give you as much of an outline as I can. We're going to try to walk through this introduction as systematically as I can so that we can sort of have a clear understanding of what to take away from this. But if you flip through to, let's find out where that is. After the book page, you'll see a page near the front called the conference homepage. And here's a way to use that page. You'll have notes pages for each of the sessions. So as the session progresses, you'll be able to take notes from what you hear in the session. But there on the homepage, as you think of resources that you need to go out and get, write them down on the homepage. As you think of people that you need to talk to, remind yourself of them by writing them down on the homepage. If someone mentions a book, you can write it down on the homepage. There are to-do items, write it down. Websites. You know, write it down on the homepage. So the homepage is going to be a place for you to come back to write down things that you need to remember to do or resources you need to remember to get, things that you want to follow up on. It just gives you a place to hold those. And then as you go through the folder, you've got ample room, hopefully, for notes on each of the sessions. So use this booklet. And then what you can do with this little booklet then is after we get done, file that away. You've got that as a resource, and hopefully that'll help you over the years as you witness to Muslim people, all right? So we're going to seek to equip you. Secondly, we want to encourage you. In your Bible, you have the truth of Almighty God in your hands. That is a tremendous blessing. I, as I've been studying this, I've just been more grateful to God for the Bible, for the Word of God. I just have been, adored the Bible more, been grateful to God for the Bible more. The more that I study this, the more thankful I am for the truth that we have in Christ. So you have the truth of God in your hands. As such, being the truth of God, it is unassailable. Unassailable. We've commented before that in witnessing to people with the truth of God, you're fishing in a stocked barrel. you can't lose. The truth of God is unassailable. It doesn't need to be defended. It just needs to be proclaimed. You know, Luther said it's like a lion in a cage. You just need to let it out. And that is true with respect to Islam, with respect to the Quran. And we're going to see that as we go through this next couple of days. It is powerfully true in the face of any false religion, right? Certainly Islam. We just need to know it better. The Bible. We need to know God better through the Bible, through His Word. And with the Spirit's help, we need to know how best we can proclaim Christ as a witness to Muslim people. So I hope this conference will encourage you. I hope that you'll be encouraged by the Word of God as we go through this. I hope that you'll be emboldened in your witness for Christ. You're going to hear useful comparisons and contrasts. And again, I just exhort you to think. As we're walking through, you hear something, think through, if I'm in a conversation with a Muslim person, someone that's enslaved in that darkness, how can I best communicate the truth of God to them to help them see? And we're here, we're presuppositionalists. We believe that the Bible is the Word of God, that in the power of the Spirit of God, it's the Word of God that is used to convert the soul, convert the sinner. And so you'll hear, I pray, arguments and useful comparisons, useful contrast to help someone see the error that they're in. There are going to be arguments for the truth of God, and specifically as it relates to the error of Islam. So we want to equip you. We want to encourage you. Lastly, we want to exhort you. Okay? Be a faithful witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. With this information, go forward in your witness for Christ and fearlessly and boldly engage Muslim people. I know the first time that I ever witnessed to a Muslim person, it was just, I knew where to go with the Bible, had no idea where to go to help them. Just didn't know enough to talk to them, but it spurred me on, just like it does, right? When you witness, you're talking to somebody, you don't have an answer, forces you to go back and study, forces you to go back and learn. Oh, this is a time of preparation for that. And so when you engage Muslim people, you'll be bold, confident to be able to talk to them about what their faith teaches and what the truth says. Taking from Paul's example, Christians should be able to say that our heart's desire and prayer to God for Muslim people is that they may be saved. That we might bear them witness that some have a zeal for a God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of the God. And it is Christ who is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. So, to equip, to encourage, and to exhort you. Tomorrow into Sunday morning, and we in helping us with that, myself included, we're blessed by God to have some men with us that have spent very valuable time preparing on our behalf. And so I want to take just a moment and introduce them to you. We'll spend a little more time introducing them as their sessions come up. But first, we have Pastor Jeffrey Johnson. So Pastor Jeff, raise your hand if you don't mind. Let them know you are. You get an opportunity. Yes. And thank you, brother. We're very excited to have Pastor Jeff with us. If you get a chance, an opportunity to meet Pastor Jeff, say hello. Pastor Jeff is from Grace Bible Church, a Reformed Baptist church in Conway, Arkansas. He's here with his wife, Letha. Welcome to you as well. They have three boys, Martin, Christian, and Britton, and their little girl, Evelyn, is here with them, but not due until April. So we're excited about that as well. Pastor Jeff has a Ph.D. in systematics from Veritas Theological Seminary, and we have several of his very helpful books out on the tables out there. And please go and buy them. They're very good, and we're going to send Pastor Jeff home empty-handed. And we want to load those books back in any kind of suitcase, so we're going to take care of that for him. And I was watching the news this morning and had a little clip that I saw about where Pastor Jeff and Letha are from, so I was going to see if Brother Edgar can put that up for us. Thank you, brother. This is where Pastor Jeff and Letha have just come from. With no audio. Okay. Well, I can paraphrase for us hearing impaired. It's snowing a lot in Little Rock, Arkansas. When I got up this morning, I was watching the news, and Pastor Jeff and Letha from Conway, just outside of Little Rock, it is almost blizzard conditions there, so they've come down to a little more warmth in Orlando, but it's been cold in Little Rock. So but welcome to Pastor Jeff. We're grateful to have you, brother. Also with us for this conference is Pastor Mark Fuss. Very grateful for Pastor Mark. So, yep. We know all that applause is thanking the Lord for these brothers. Pastor Mark is from Sovereign Grace Bible Chapel in Englewood, Florida, here with his wife, Christy. And they have three daughters. I know you know Pastor Mark and Christy. You've had an opportunity to meet them as they visited. Their three daughters, Meredith, Abigail, and a treasured import to Cornerstone, our own Emily, soon to be Emily Miller. So very thankful to have the Fusses with us. Pastor Mark has an MA from Southwestern, and we'll be speaking tomorrow on Jihad and the Quran. So we're excited about that. And lastly, we have a pastor that virtually needs no introduction. He, right here from Cornerstone Baptist Church, he lives by the life slogan that bald is beautiful. Pastor Rick's life verse is Leviticus chapter 13, verse 40. which reads, "As for the man whose hair has fallen from his head, he is bald, but he is clean." All right. So we know, it's Pastor Rick and his wife, Jessica. I'm just grateful for that, brother. All right. Now, with this, our goal for the next couple of days is to give you what I hope will be an intellectually honest, fair, charitable, and representative view of the history, theology, and practice of Islam. If you're visiting with us, our intent is not to offend, but we want to understand and we want to respond with the truth. Unlike many, we see the truths of Islam or the teachings of Islam and the teachings of Christianity to be mutually exclusive. Both cannot be true simultaneously. We pray that you'll be persuaded by the truth as you listen over the next few days. With that in mind, what I'd like to do to get us started is to ask Pastor Mark, brother, if you wouldn't mind just coming and praying for us, to pray for the conference, pray for the speakers, pray for the saints to be bold in their witness, and then we'd pray that the Lord would be pleased to glorify himself and the fruitfulness of his people in witnessing to Muslims with the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So thank you, brother. And let's pray together.
Dear Lord God, we thank you for this time. We thank you that we can be here. We know it's a privilege to be able to be here. And we want to worship you and pray that you'd please would be honored in this conference. We thank you that we have you, Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that we would value you more in the comparison with the religion of Islam. Lord, we pray that you please would help the speakers to speak truth, to speak from the research they've done, to speak well of from the Bible, to speak as those who believe truly and completely the things that you've spoken in your word. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us to listen well and to consider how we can apply the truths that we hear and so that we can care for people's souls. Lord, please help us to worship you and honor you in this conference. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that we have you as our Savior and for atonement for our sins. We pray, please help us now to worship you in this conference. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. All right. Okay, well, let's get started. What I hope to do in this time that we've got tonight is to give you a broad overview. I was thinking through this as I was preparing, trying not to make this session just a data download, but I'm afraid that I'm going to fail miserably at trying not to do that. There's just so much information, but the goal would be tonight to give you a broad scope basis or a foundational understanding of Islam that you can build on as you listen to the other sessions that will come after. I know I'm doing a session tomorrow afternoon on Sharia law. I'm just looking at some of the sessions that Pastor Jeff is going to do, the session that Pastor Mark is going to do. And this outline, this sort of introduction, is going to help you as you listen to what they're going to be saying during those sessions. I'm going to try my hardest not to step on their toes too much and go too far into a subject that they're going to be covering, but I want to give you sort of a basis for the next couple of days. Let me give you a loose outline. Maybe at the top of your notes page, you can begin to write these three areas down, and we're going to spend some time in each one of these three areas and just give you quite a bit of information under each one. The first we'll look at is what defines a Muslim? What defines a Muslim? Secondly, we're going to look at the revelation that's been given to them. The revelation that's been given to them. And then lastly, we're going to look at where that revelation came from, how it was given. So what defines a Muslim? We're going to look at the revelation that's been given to them in a broad way. And then where that revelation came from, and who it came through in particular. All right, so as we get into this now, the Muslim population of the world today is estimated at about 2.1 billion, with a B, billion people. It's one of the fastest growing religious groups in the world. It's growing at nearly a rate of about 2% per year. The largest number of Muslims actually live in Southeast Asia. Well over half the Muslim population lives in South or Southeast Asia. The highest per capita Muslim population is obviously in the Middle East, and in northern Africa, where there are some countries that have a per capita Muslim population of 97% to 98%. So a very high density of Muslim populations in some Middle Eastern countries, countries in North Africa, as we would expect. The rise in the Muslim population in Europe, especially here recently, has been dramatic. The Pew Research Center puts the Muslim population in the United States around 3 million, and estimates are that that number will more than double by the year 2030. Now, if that stat concerns you, it should concern you that more than 77% of the people in this country profess to be Christian. The religiously unaffiliated in the United States of America is the fastest growing block of population in our country, religiously unaffiliated. Basically, the stats just simply prove that Christians, genuine Christians, are dramatically outnumbered as they always have been. So don't let the rise of Islam give you any pause or cause for concern. God is sovereign and Christians have the truth. So we're always dramatically outnumbered. We have no shortage of lost people to talk to, right? The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So let's define Muslims then. What defines a Muslim? Muslims are basically divided into two primary groups today. We see these groups in the news frequently, Shia and Sunni. It's important to understand that not all Muslims are the same. Christianity is often criticized for having so many different denominations or splinter groups, but Islam is essentially the same. Respect to many variations in theology, many variations in their application of the law, many variations in practice. So the two primary groups within Islam today are the Sunnis and the Shia. And those major groups are divided into various splinter groups and sects. So each one divides further. There's a third group, not really much in existence today. The Sunnis and Shia are still very prevalent. These groups originally divided over succession to Muhammad. How succession should be decided. So when Muhammad died, he didn't leave a successor. Sunnis believe that a successor called a caliph should be elected. That caliph, a Sunni leader, should be elected. And it's elected. He was elected through a process in the Muslim community called a shura. And many Muslims believe that this was the foundation or sort of the roots of democratic society in our world. They elected a successor called the caliph. About 90% of all Muslims today are Sunni Muslims. The word Sunni is from the word sunnah, which refers to the teachings and example of the Prophet Muhammad. So sunnah refers to the teachings and the example of the Prophet Muhammad. So Sunni refers to those who follow the teachings and example of Muhammad. They may call themselves Sunnis, but all Muslims would say that they do that. All Muslims would confess to follow the teachings and the example of Muhammad. Shia Muslims, on the other hand, believe that a successor to Muhammad should come through Muhammad's bloodline or from his family. So there's the difference between Sunnis and Shia. Sunnis believe that the caliph should be elected by a consensus of the community. Shia believe that a successor should come through Muhammad's bloodline. Now these caliphs, Shia caliphs, are believed to be chosen by God from what the Muslims call al-Bayt, from the family of the house, from the family of Muhammad. And these caliphs are called imams. You hear the word imam tossed around quite a bit. In Sunni Islam or Sunni Muslims, an imam is a local prayer leader. So if you went to the mosque, there's going to be an imam that leads prayer at the mosque. An imam might be someone who leads prayer at a house, a local Sunni leader, but to the Shia, an imam is a leader of the community. It's an imam. These imams in Shia Islam possess isma, or infallibility. These imams are said to, by the Shia, to have characteristics like the Lord Jesus Christ, or characteristics that would only be attributable to God. And they are viewed as examples for the community to follow, and not dissimilar to Roman Catholicism and the Pope. The Pope as the vicar of Christ, the Pope having infallibility when he sits in the seat, right? Sunni Muslims also refer to an imam, but this reference is completely different. This is an important distinction to make. To Sunni Muslims, the Shia or the Imam is one that leads prayer. The one who leads a school of theology, the one who's a scholar in the Quran or a scholar in the Hadith, we'll talk about those books later. But to Shia, the Imam is a caliph or a leader that possesses infallibility. Shia, the word Shia, is an abbreviation of Shi'atu Ali, or followers of Ali. Now, if you remember, Shia decided that, or they believed, that a successor to Muhammad should come through bloodline, a descendant of Muhammad. And so they believed that the first caliph, the first imam, should have been Muhammad's cousin and his son-in-law, Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Ali Talib. The Shia believed that he was the first because he was of the bloodline of Muhammad, and that these imams, these caliphs, were chosen by God from the house of Muhammad. The Sunnis finally got around to electing Ali Talib as the fourth of their caliphs. The Shia Muslims, although a minority, about 10% of the Muslim population, they occupy a vast majority in countries today like Iran, Iraq, Bahrain, a moderate majority in Yemen. And they would also claim to follow the teachings of the example of Muhammad, but would also submit themselves to these descendants of Muhammad, caliphs or imams. And these caliphs are to rule over a caliphate. You've heard that word, a caliphate. If you watch the news in reference to ISIS and what's going on in the Middle East, they want to set up a theocracy over which the caliph or the imam would rule. Those are primarily Shia Muslims that are over there doing that. Now, this succession, they believe, is taught in the Quran, and that Muhammad appointed Ali in a farewell sermon before his death, and that's recorded in the Hadith. In the Quran, in Surah chapter 3, or Surah 3, 33 and 34, it says this: truly Allah chose Adam and Noah and the family of Abraham and the family of Imran above the nations, offspring one of the other, and Allah is hearing and knowing. So from Surah 3, Muslims believe that the imam or the caliph, the leader of Shia Muslims, should be from Muhammad's bloodline. Okay? Now, splits have then occurred, as you would imagine, within Shia Islam over recognized succession. Even in his bloodline, who should take over? So main groups then within Shia Islam being the Twelvers, Zaydi, Ismaili, and just these sects and these divisions, there are many, many, many of them. It's just important to know that you can't treat all of them the same. If you're talking to somebody, there are many differences, and some of these differences are important differences. So with various differences, Shia Muslims believe that the last imam in this succession will be the Mahdi that you're going to hear about on Sunday morning from Pastor Rick. The last imam in this succession will be the Mahdi who will rule over the theocracy, rule over the caliphate, before the day of judgment. And his goal is to establish an Islamic state and to apply Islamic law. That's why when we're watching the news today, they talk about Shia Muslims and ISIS and the caliphate having eschatological or end times concerns. They believe that the Twelvers under Shia Islam believe that the Mahdi is currently living on the earth. He's already here. He's been living on the earth for several hundred years now. And that he is going to rule over this final Islamic state, the caliphate. His rule, by the way, coincides with the second coming of Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ comes, he will assist the Mahdi in establishing the Islamic state and ruling over the caliphate. The Twelvers believe that he's already on the earth, the 12th imam since Ali Talib, the first one. Okay. Now, Muslims, by definition, are committed to the practice of Islam. You want to be a Muslim, you're going to commit yourself to the practice of Islam. The practice of Islam is broadly spelled out in the five pillars of Islam. The five pillars of Islam. All Muslims, regardless of group, essentially hold to the five responsibilities of a Muslim as a rule of faith and practice. These are called the five pillars of Islam. Now, these pillars are summarized in the Hadith of Gabriel. The Hadith of Gabriel, we'll talk about that in a moment too. And Shia and Sunni Muslims both agree on the basics, but there are some important differences. For Sunni Muslims, these are the five pillars. One is the Shahada. The Shahada is a declaration of faith. It's something that's to be said in Arabic, and it's something that is to be said in earnest. It's to be recited. Basically, the statement is this: there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. It's the Shahada. Now, that to that, the Shia add that Ali is the Wali, or the guidance of God. So you have the basic Shahada: there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. And to that Shahada, the Shia Muslims add that Ali is the guidance of God, meaning that they hold to succession from Muhammad's bloodline and not succession through election or shura. Now, this is said in earnest to convert to Islam or to be a Muslim. Muslims will whisper it in the ear of a newborn baby. They'll whisper it in the ear of a dying person. In their five prayers daily, in all five prayers, they're reciting the Shahada, among other things. And if you look at the black flag that you see on the news from ISIS, there's a flag for Islam, which is called the Black Standard. It's just a plain black flag. But if you look at the flag of ISIS, it's a black flag, and the Shahada in Arabic is the white lettering that you see on the front of that flag. This is this recitation, the Shahada, this declaration of faith. That's the first of the five pillars. You must, in earnest, recite the Shahada. Secondly is Salat. Salat. These are spelled essentially how they sound. The Salat is Islamic prayer. It includes five daily prayers according to the Sunnah. Those prayers are said at dawn, at noon, afternoon, evening, and night, and all done while facing the Kaaba in Mecca. The Kaaba meaning the cube. It's considered the house of God, the Kaaba. It's in the largest mosque in the world is in Mecca. In the center of that mosque is this black cube, maybe you've seen pictures of that, called the Kaaba, similar to the Holy of Holies in the temple. That's how they view that. And Muslims are to wash before prayer in a ceremony called wudu, or purification. Thirdly, third pillar is zakat. And zakat is giving. Now, the word for zakat means purification or growth. And so the way Muslims view that is that when you give, it's like pruning. Giving is like pruning, and it encourages further growth, encourages new growth. Muslims believe, as Christians do, all things belong to, well, in their case, they believe that all things belong to Allah. We believe that all things belong to God. And some countries apply zakat like a tax, as much as 20%. So zakat is giving. Fourth is Psalm, S-A-W-M. It's the transliteration of that word. And that's fasting. They have three kinds of fasting: ritual fasting, they have compensatory or compensation fasting for repentance, then they have ascetic fasting. Fasting is required of all Muslims during the month of Ramadan, and they fast from dawn to dusk. They'll make exceptions. So in Islam, there are exceptions for fasting for pregnant women, children, those with a medical condition, and so on. But Muslims are expected to fast on a regular basis, and especially through the month of Ramadan. And the last of the five pillars is called Hajj. Hajj. Every able-bodied Muslim, man or woman, is required to make a pilgrimage to Mecca at least once in their lifetime, called the Hajj. So they make that pilgrimage. It's as they are able to. If they're unable to, don't have to. As they're able to, they make that trip at least once in their lifetime. Within 10 kilometers of the Kaaba, again housed in the largest mosque in the world, they're required to wear white sheets of Imram clothing. They perform or participate in various rituals while they're there. They walk seven times around the Kaaba, praying. It's called Tawaf. Or there's a ritual of symbolically stoning the devil that they do in the city of Mina. Maybe you've seen that before. They throw pebbles at three different walls in the city of Mina. Ritual called Rami. So the five pillars of Islam: the Shahada, Salat, Zakat, the Psalm, and the Hajj. Now, for Shia Muslims, the arrangement is a bit different, but all those five pillars are included. But for the Shias, there are also others added. They have what is called 10 ancillaries of the faith. So for Shia Muslims, they add additional requirements totaling what are called 10 ancillaries of the faith. First, and I'm sure I'm going to just do a terrible job of pronouncing some of these Arabic words, Amr bil Maruf, which is to urge or to instruct what is right. The Shia Muslims have an obligation spelled out in their 10 ancillaries of the faith to urge or instruct what is right. The second, Nahi anil Munkar, which is to forbid what is wrong. Sounds good so far, right? Urge what is right, forbid what is wrong. Tawala is to express love toward what is good. And Tabara is to express hatred toward evil. They're to express love toward good or express hatred toward evil. The last of these in the 10 ancillaries of the faith that are different from those five pillars listed in Sunni Islam is jihad. So for Shia Muslims, jihad is one of the 10 ancillaries of the faith required of Shia Muslims. Jihad is striving or struggling for Islam. It can have two meanings, and there are many that would press for two different understandings of jihad. One is an inner spiritual struggle, the other being an outer physical struggle against the enemies of Islam. However, within Islam, there is a clear consensus that jihad involves an armed struggle against wrongdoers. An armed struggle. In all references to jihad in the Bukhari collection of hadith, jihad means warfare. Some Sunni Muslims even call it the sixth pillar of Islam. Now, some of these terms you've probably heard on the news. A person engaged in jihad is called a mujahid. The plural of that is the mujahideen. Those are people who are engaged in jihad. Some try to assess or assert that jihadists have hijacked a peaceful religion. We're going to see as we go through this, and especially in Pastor Mark's coverage of that tomorrow, that is not the case. Shia claim to be more literal in their understanding of the Quran, more literal in their application of the Quran, and Shia are more militant, believing that in implementing fully the teaching of the Quran, they must establish a theocracy and drive out enemies of the faith. So that gives you an idea of Muslims inside Islam, how they're divided, and a good basis for how to think through the different groups. Let's talk about their revelation, what's been revealed to them. Theologically, Muslims believe that Islam is the worship of the one true God whose name is Allah. And Allah has revealed himself to man. And Pastor Jeff is going to be going through that more in detail on the God of Islam Sunday morning. But Allah is derived from Al-Ilah, meaning the God. Islam is fiercely monotheistic. Like Jews and Christians, Muslims would say that the Lord, our God, the Lord is one, one God. And that tenet of Islam is called Tawhid. And it's reflected in the Shahada. The Shahada is, there is no God but Allah. That reflects Tawhid. There is one God, monotheistic. However, unlike Christians, Muslims view the Trinity as polytheism. God has no partners or equals. And to say that God is three persons, one God, would be shirk to them, or sin to them, the unforgivable sin. If you die in shirk, you die an unpardonable death, an unpardonable sin. God has no partners equal. Surah 4:48 says this, "Surely Allah forgives not that a partner should be set up with him, and forgives all besides that to whom he pleases." So in other words, not even Allah will forgive someone who commits shirk or polytheism. Whoever sets up a partner with Allah, he devises indeed a great sin. So polytheism or idolatry, including God coming as a man, is considered shirk in Islam. A person who commits shirk is a mushrik, and it's considered unforgivable if you die as a polytheist. Allah might forgive any sin at death except for shirk. There's an example in Islam of in the hadith of Muhammad asking Allah if he can pray for the people of the book, Christians or pray for Jews. Jews, Christians particularly, considered polytheists shirk, and Allah strictly forbids Muhammad to pray for the people of the book. But then he asked to be able to pray for Ali Talib, or for his uncle, Abu Talib, pray for his uncle, and Allah allows him to pray for his uncle, and because of Muhammad's prayer, Abu Talib is placed in the most favorable position possible in hell. And it's a position at the least amount of torment, the least amount of discomfort in hell, and it's a place where Abu Talib is said to be in his sandals, and the fire around his ankles is so hot that his brains boil. And that's the most favorable position for someone who has committed shirk. Now, Muslims believe in angels, the chief of whom is Gabriel, who gave revelation to Muhammad. Surah 50 teaches that you have two angels assigned to you that record your good and evil deeds. They believe in a future judgment, and they believe in a resurrection. At the future judgment, your good deeds will be weighed together with your evil deeds in what is called the scales. You'll end up in either paradise or hell. And Pastor Rick's going to talk about that on Sunday morning. Muslims believe that Islam predates Christianity and Judaism. That may come as a surprise to some folks, that Judaism and Christianity are actually corruptions or perversions of Islam. That means, if you think about that, Abraham was a Muslim, Moses was a Muslim, the patriarchs were all Muslim, and the Lord Jesus Christ was a Muslim. So in many ways, many cases, our Old Testament figures are considered prophets of Islam. So through the Old Testament, Adam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, David, Solomon, Jonah, John the Baptist, Jesus, and so on, all of these are prophets in Islam. The greatest of these prophets, unquestionably, Muhammad. That means that Muslims believe that our biblical history is actually and primarily Islamic history, and that it's been given by Allah. Allah and His revealed word are thought to be eternally existent, and the final revelation of God's word, Allah's word to man, was given by Muhammad, and it's called the Quran. Now, in addition to the Quran, there are three other books that are considered revealed by Allah. The first of those is the Torah, the first five books of our Old Testament, the books given to Moses, right? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the Torah. The second are the Psalms, or the Zabur, that are revealed to David. And the next, in addition to the Quran, revealed by Allah, is called the Gospel, or the Injil. And it was an original book revealed to Jesus. It was Isa in the Quran. So, delivered by or revealed by Allah to man, the Torah, the Psalms, the Gospel, and the Quran. Let me read you a section from the Quran. This is Surah 5, beginning in verse or Ayah 44. Listen to what the Quran says. Indeed, we sent down the Torah. Now, remember, that's the first five books of our Old Testament. We sent down the Torah in which was guidance and light. The prophets who submitted to Allah judged by it for the Jews, as did the rabbis and scholars by that which they were entrusted to the scripture of Allah, and they were witnesses thereto. So do not fear the people, but fear me, and do not exchange my verses for a small price. And whoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then it is those who are the disbelievers. Now, notice in verse 44 there that the Torah was revealed to the Jews at that time. So in the Quran, when you have, or these books, the Torah, the Zabur, the Psalms, or the Gospel, all written to that group of people at that particular time. That which comes later has authority over that and may correct or may change that. The Torah was revealed to the Jews at that time. It says in verse 45, it says this, and we ordained for them therein a life for a life, an eye for an eye, a nose for a nose, an ear for an ear, a tooth for a tooth, and for wounds is legal retribution. But whoever gives up his right as charity, it is an expiation or a removal of guilt for him. Whoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then it is those who are the wrongdoers. Then listen to verse 46. And Allah sent, following in their footsteps, Jesus, the son of Mary, confirming that which came before him in the Torah, we gave him the gospel. Now, when we think about this, gospel, we think of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? But this, the gospel that was delivered to Injil, or the gospel Injil, delivered to Isa, Jesus, was a book that we no longer have. It was a single book delivered to Jesus. It's no longer recorded. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John tried to, at a later time, reconstitute that lost gospel. And so in that putting together or trying to reconstitute that gospel, there was corruption added. And so they gave him the gospel, in which, it says, was guidance and light, and confirming that which preceded it of the Torah as guidance and instruction for the righteous. So in verse 47, and let the people of the gospel judge by what Allah has revealed therein. And whoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed, then it is those who are defiantly disobedient. And we have revealed to you, O Muhammad, the book in truth, which is referring to the Quran, confirming that which preceded it of the scripture and as a criterion over it. So judge between them by what Allah has revealed and do not follow their inclinations away from what has come to you of the truth. To each of you we prescribed a law and a method. Had Allah willed, he would have made you one nation united in religion. But he intended to test you in what he has given you. So race to all that is good. To Allah is your return altogether, and he will then inform you considering that over which you used to differ. In other words, the Quran is over all of those other books, over the Torah, the Psalms, the Gospel. The Quran has authority over it. Now, Muslims believe that these texts would be familiar, but they are irreparably corrupted. So those texts, our Old Testament, our New Testament, irreparably corrupted, perverted. The Jews, for example, corrupted the Torah for personal gain to show that Isaac and not Ishmael was Abraham's heir. It's one of the ways that the Old Testament was corrupted. The Jews changed it to show that Isaac was Abraham's heir and not Ishmael. Therefore, descendants of Ishmael are the rightful heirs of the promised land. That's causing problems in the Middle East even today, right? For example, another example, the Injil or the gospel given as a revelation to Jesus has actually been lost. And what we know today is Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are reconstructions or attempts at reconstruction. And doctrines that we see there, like the Trinity or Jesus being the Son of God, were inserted later. So although these texts are mentioned in the Quran, and the Quran actually instructs Muslims to refer to them, much of them are no longer considered trustworthy. So if you think about that now, how do you know what portions can be trusted or what portions are revealed by Allah? Well, basically, it's those portions of our Bible that agree with the Quran. So the Quran comes later. It's the final revelation of Allah to man. And so it's considered to confirm what was written prior. So if something doesn't agree with the Quran, that's how you tell that it's been corrupted. Muslim writer Badru Katrega said this. He said, the Quran, as the final revelation, is the perfection and culmination of all truth contained in the earlier scriptures. Though sent in Arabic, it is the book for all times and for all mankind. The purpose of the Quran is to guard the previous revelations by restoring the eternal truth of Allah. And the Quran is the torchlight by which humanity can be rightly guided onto the straight path. So the Quran, let's talk about that a little bit. The Quran then is a word meaning the recitation. And it's the final, ultimately authoritative, revealed word of Allah to Muslims today. So it was given word by word in Arabic by Allah to Muhammad through the angel Gabriel in small pieces over 23 years. Now this began in a cave on Mount Hira just outside of Mecca. First revelation on December 22nd, 609 AD, when Muhammad was 40. And it concluded in 632 when he died. So revealed by the angel Gabriel to Muhammad in a cave outside Mecca, beginning in 609 when Muhammad was 40. Muslims believe that the word of Allah has eternally existed in heaven. There are plates there even now with the original. And what has been revealed through Gabriel to Muhammad was revealed word for word by exact copy to the prophet through dictation. So it's different from our view of inspiration, right? You know, understand from the Bible, how the Bible talks about inspiration. The Word of God wasn't breathed out in the same way that we would understand that from 2 Timothy chapter 3. It wasn't that holy men of God spoke as they were moved along by the Holy Spirit, as in 2 Peter chapter 1. It was dictated word for word to Muhammad. Now, as a result, it would be sin to a Muslim to think that Muhammad or any other prophet writers had any imprint whatsoever on the words of Allah as recorded in the Quran. It would be shirk to believe that their personality or their style, their writing style, came out in those words. It is, and this is important to understand, we'll hear that later, it is only the words and personality and style of Allah himself. Everything that's written there has no imprint from Muhammad on it. Now you can imagine, there's a great deal of reverence given to the Quran. A true Muslim, a devout Muslim, recites the Quran daily, reads the Quran. The only true Quran is in Arabic. Once it's translated, it's really no longer the Quran. It's only a guide. In reverence for the Quran, they will add inflection, enhancing its beauty, and so it's song-like. They'll actually sing, chant sections of the Quran. It isn't to be put on the ground. Nothing's to be put on top of it. Muslims won't leave a Quran on the bed, on a chair, on a seat. That's where someone has sat. Muslims from childhood are taught to memorize the Quran. There are those that have the entire Quran memorized. A devout Muslim will read a 30th of the Quran each night so that he reads through it once per month. The Quran is made up of 114 surahs or chapters, verses called ayahs. It's not quite as long as our New Testament, about 4/5 the length of our New Testament. Often, very difficult to follow. It's difficult to follow. Can be very confusing because it's not arranged chronologically. It's not arranged topically. The surahs are arranged by length. And so the longest surah up front, surah number 1, to the shortest surah, 114. And because of that arrangement, it's just sometimes very difficult to follow. Additionally, the text in the Quran is divided over a Meccan period and a Medinan period. Muhammad began living in Mecca. That's where the revelation began, in that cave outside of Mecca. He later moves to Medina. And so there was revelation given to Muhammad as he was in both of those locations. And you have that revealed word, the Meccan period and the Medinan period. Because the Quran is arranged by length, all of those revelations and that development is jumbled together. And so sometimes really difficult to tell what the context is for what you're reading. And that's why it's really important to have something called the Hadith. Hadith gives context to the Quran. We'll talk about that in a moment. With the Medinan text, as things progress from Mecca to Medina, the text becomes increasingly militaristic, increasingly violent. We'll see that also. And there are several reasons, I want to give you some examples of this, several reasons why Muslims believe that the Quran is the word of Allah. One reason they believe it's the word of Allah is because they say it's a perfect, because of its unity. Most Muslims today argue for an absolute unity in the copies of the Quran. They'll boast of no errors. They'll boast of no differences between thousands, millions of copies. And they'll explain this by saying that the astounding unity over the centuries can only be possible because Allah himself has revealed it and preserved it in its exact form. They'll say because of that unity, it must be the word of Allah. So no other book, they say, is so divinely revealed and so divinely preserved. And the proof of that is in all the variants that exist. So if you look at our Bible, thousands upon thousands of manuscripts and variants. Now, there's a whole study, textual criticism, dealing with variants. Now, the Quran is also called the miracle of Muhammad because he was thought to be illiterate. Now, that fact is debatable. Some reasons to think that Muhammad wasn't illiterate. But they view the Quran in its beauty and in its unity as the miracle of Muhammad because Muhammad was thought to be illiterate. What is not debatable is that as the Quran is being written down over those 23 years, you have the Quran recorded on small pieces and fragments, sometimes leaves, sometimes bone fragments, like the shoulder bone of an ox, written down on small fragments over that 23-year period. Parchment, Some of it was only memorized. It was only committed to the memory of the person to whom it was recited, not even written down. And so after Muhammad's death, if you can imagine, when Muhammad died in 632, there wasn't a compiled Quran available when he died. So different Muslims, different sects, began compiling the Quran from all the fragments and pieces that they had available, including from memory, some of those who had memorized when it was recited. Now, not only were there differences among what was compiled, but compiled copies were different. After Muhammad died, there was debate over what was considered actual revelation, what wasn't. These small pieces had to be compiled from various locations, various sources. And so there were variants, there were considerable differences in the copies that were available immediately after Muhammad's death for a period after that time. That was very concerning to the Muslims at that time. And without much debate over this, there was a caliph, an elected caliph, Uthman, who desperately wanted to establish a standard version of the Quran. He wanted to make sure that they had a single unified copy of the Quran, of Allah's revelation to Muhammad. So he established a standard version, now known as Uthman's Codex. So they established this one standardized version of the Quran. They sent that off to people who had different versions of the Quran and told them to burn their copies and use the one Uthman's Codex that was sent to them. So they established one copy of the Quran and destroyed all the others. And from that point forward, have used that one copy. That's why there's such unity to the Quran. Now think about that for a moment. From the beginning, Islam has not been open to scholarly criticism or scholarly examination. There's no real basis for exegesis in the Quran. I wouldn't preach an expositional sermon from the Quran. Those that seriously question it over the years have had to publish under pseudonyms because those that opposed the Quran or opposed Muhammad were killed. So there's just no serious, they don't allow for serious criticism or critical examination. But they'll claim that it's perfect, that it's unified, and it's the actual revelation of Gabriel, of Allah through Gabriel to Muhammad. Secondly, one of the reasons they believe that the Quran is the word of Allah is that its dictation and its beauty reveal that the Quran has come from Allah. They'll say that no other book exists with such transcendent poetry and prose. They give special credence to this, considering that Muhammad was illiterate. There's an example. Let me read to you this from... This is some of their literature, a brief illustrated guide to understanding Islam. And that's just an introduction. And on page 32, Islam issued a challenge. It's called the Great Challenge. And it's a challenge to produce one chapter, like the chapters of the Holy Quran. And here it is in the Quran. This is what Surah 2, 23 through 25 says. He says, "If you are in doubt about what we have revealed, our Quran, to our worshiper Muhammad, then produce a chapter like it. Call your witnesses, supporters, and helpers besides God if you are truthful. And if you do not do it, and you can never do it, then fear the fire, whose fuel is men and stones. It has been prepared for disbelievers. Oh, give good news, O Muhammad, to those who believe and do good deeds, that for them are gardens, paradise, in which rivers flow." So now they'll state in here that ever since the Quran was revealed 14 centuries ago, no one has been able to produce a single chapter like the chapters of the Quran in their beauty, eloquence, splendor, wise legislation, true information, true prophecy, and other perfect attributes. I was, you know, doing my study and of this and just remembering Pastor Marcos' sermon last Sunday from Philippians chapter 2. And just what a glorious, beautiful text Philippians chapter 2 is. There's nothing that exists anywhere in Islam even remotely close to that one section of scripture from Philippians chapter 2. It's just glorious. But this is a challenge that's been issued. Now, there have been those that have taken up the challenge, and many of those that have taken up the challenge have been killed. But there's a challenge exists to try to reproduce a section of the a section of text similar to that which is found in the Quran at its beauty. Another proof that the Quran is the word of Allah is the testimony of changed lives. Testimony of changed lives proves that the Quran is from Allah. Now, they don't mean what we mean when we say that. We say that people's lives have been changed when they come to faith in Christ. They don't mean the same thing. What they're talking about is sheer numbers. Sheer numbers. There have been so many people that have converted to Islam. It must be from Allah. It's the fastest growing religion, so it must be from Allah. This is from their literature on page 40 here. At the end of this chapter, it may be appropriate to point out an important indication of the truth of Islam. It is well known that in the USA and the whole world, Islam is the fastest growing religion. They give some illustrations of that. This phenomenon indicates that Islam is truly a religion from God. It is unreasonable to think that so many Americans and people from different countries have converted to Islam without careful consideration and deep contemplation before concluding that Islam is true. These converts have come from different countries, classes, races, and walks of life. They include scientists, professors, philosophers, journalists, politicians, actors, and athletes. So basically what they're stating with that, the testimony of changed lives is simply the numbers that have converted to Islam, and they use that to indicate God's blessing, or Allah's blessing, that Islam must be from Allah. Fourthly, they'll say that the Quran is upheld by modern science. That's the reason that it's from Allah, is the Quran is upheld by modern science. I want to give you an example of this now. One of these examples, and many of them are listed here in this little book, the Quran on human embryonic development. The Holy Quran, God, in the Holy Quran, Allah speaks about the stages of man's embryonic development. Listen to this from Surah 23. We created man from an extract of clay. Then we made him as a drop in a place of settlement firmly fixed. Then we made the drop into an aliqua. Now, aliqua, that word means leech or means suspended thing or means blood clot. Why? Then it says, then we made the aliqua, the leech, suspended thing, or blood clot, into a mudga. That word, mudga, means chewed substance. Now, you take that ayah, that verse from Surah 23, and I don't know if you can see this or not, but here is a little picture of a human embryo in its earliest stages of development. And then right below that is a picture of a leech. So you say now, you know, how did Muhammad know that a human embryo looked like a leech if he wasn't getting revelation directly from Allah who made us? It looks like a little worm, okay? So that's based on the statement, we made the drop of clay, the extract of clay, into an aliqua, a leech. If you flip the page here, it shows a picture of an embryo, and now below the embryo, this is described as the magda, or the chewed substance, is a piece of chewing gum. So now, if you chew that piece of chewing gum, it looks like the embryo, and so this is more affirmation that revelation has come directly from Allah, that Muhammad knew that an embryo looked like a piece of, I don't think they chewed chewing gum back then, but it looks like a chewed substance, okay? So it upholds science. If you flip the page, another example of this is mountains. That in the Quran, in Surah 78, Allah says, have we not made the earth as a bed and the mountains as pegs? And so from that, he says in Surah 16, he has set firm mountains in the earth so that it would not shake with you. And so now the theory is from the Quran that mountains actually keep the earth from shaking. I'm not sure if that's earthquakes, how that works, but now they cite scientific evidence for this, that mountains have roots and mountains look like pegs. And mountains in plate tectonics keep the earth from shaking. They're stabilizing the crust of the earth somehow. Now, the scientific evidence that is cited for this comes from the geological concept of mountains in the Quran by El Nagar. Comes from the third citation, geological concept of mountains in the Quran by El Nagar. The fourth citation, geological concept of mountains in the Quran by El Nagar. So their scientific evidence is coming from their own studies, their own scientists, right? Geological concept of the mountains in the Quran, the second citation also. So something about mountains there and pegs and holding the earth from shaking. On page 16, there's the Quran and the cerebrum, knowing the physiology of the brain. God has said in the Quran that in Surah 96, "No, if he does not stop, we will take him by the nasaya, the front of the head. If he does not stop, we're going to take him by the front of the head, a lying, sinful front of the head, nasaya." Now, that's what it says in Surah 96. From that, science then, upholding the Quran, knows that the frontal lobe of your brain is where sinful actions or sinful thoughts come from. And so in the Quran, Surah 96, where it's said that they're going to take that person by the front of the head, the sinful front of the head, that's Allah revealing to Muhammad that the frontal lobe of the brain is where sinful actions, sinful deeds, sinful thoughts come from. And so science, again, upholding the truth of the Quran. Now you think about it, and here's what I would encourage you to do, is go to the Bible and look at the many, many, many places where science is upheld by the Bible. Not only science that goes against what people believed at that time, but all the archaeological evidence. There's tremendous, tremendous evidence in Scripture for the Bible upheld in ways that are far, far clearer. This is good evidence for witnessing. So, the Quran is upheld by modern science. Lastly, and we know that the Quran is the word of Allah, is because of prophecy. Because of prophecy in the Quran. Muhammad was said to have known the future. Now, how is it possible that Muhammad would have known the future apart from Allah? One of the examples of prophecy in the revealed word of Allah comes to us from Deuteronomy chapter 18. And in Deuteronomy chapter 18, we'll go there in a little bit, Moses prophesied in Deuteronomy 18 of the coming of Muhammad. When Moses said in that text that he will raise up a prophet like Moses from among his brothers, Muslims believe that's a prophecy of Muhammad. Now, let me give you another example of prophecy. This is one listed in this book. It's a significant prophecy in the Quran that they believe attests to the fact that Allah gave the revealed word of God, the Quran, to Muslims. And that comes to us from Surah 30. Now listen to this from Surah 30. In verse 1, "I, Allah, am the best knower. The Romans are vanquished in a near land, and they, after their defeat, will gain victory. Within 9 years, Allah is the command before and after, and on that day the believers will rejoice. In Allah's help, he helps whom he pleases, and he is the mighty, the merciful. It is Allah's promise. Allah will not fail in his promise, but most people know not." Now this prophecy, they say, this was revealed to Muhammad in AD 615 or 616. That it's revealed in AD 615 or 616. Now it says here in this prophecy that ayah 4, within 9 years, that word bed there, bed in ayah 4, means in 3 to 9 years. So there's a range given, 3 to 9 years. So now think through this with me. Muhammad is getting revelation from Allah. In 615 or 616, the Romans are defeated. The Romans are defeated. And so Muhammad prophesies that in 3 to 9 years, or they gain a victory. I'm sorry, the Romans are victorious. In 3 to 9 years, they're going to be defeated. Well, part of the reason they're going to be defeated is because Muhammad and his army is going to attack them. Okay? So, in 3 to 9 years, they're going to be defeated. Now, this, they say, was fulfilled at the Battle of Badr in 624. Now, if you're at 615, we're not sure exactly when the revelation was given, or when the defeat happened, but if it happened in 615, then that's 9 years. If it happened in 616, 8 years. It's in that 3 to 9 year window given in ayah 4. But think about this for a moment. Now, this is very loose prophecy, right? From the beginning. When did Muhammad die? 632. So now just put all that together for a moment and look at one of the foundational prophecies written in the Quran. Roman battle takes place in 615, 616. Romans are victorious. Muhammad gets a revelation from Allah and says that in 3 to 9 years, that army is going to be defeated. So 9 years in 624, Muhammad attacks them in the Battle of Badr, and they win that battle. So the prophecy comes true. They were defeated. Muhammad dies in 632. Now again, we've got prophecy in the Bible hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of fulfilled prophecies in striking clarity, hundreds and hundreds of years before the events actually take place. But this particular prophecy, written before and fulfilled before Muhammad ever died, and questionable to begin with, is prophecy on which Muslims hang the veracity of the Quran and would say that it's a book from Allah. So again, when you start making comparisons, there's astounding evidence for the truth of the Bible, the truth of God's word. Now, with the Quran, let's talk about a few other texts quickly. Try to move on here, sorry. With the Quran, there are other extremely important writings that impact Islamic faith and practice. With the Quran, very important is the Sunnah. The Sunnah is an account of Muhammad's teachings, an account of his actions, his sayings, and his example. It's the Sunnah. There are three categories of Sunnah that Muslims follow. One are Muhammad's sayings, what he says. Two, Muhammad's actions, religious or otherwise. And three, Muhammad's silent approvals or disapprovals. When Muhammad kept silent and didn't oppose something that happened, he's tacitly giving approval for that to happen. Or sometimes in the Quran it says that he smiles in regard to an action by someone around him. When Muhammad smiles, he's giving approval to that action. So in the Sunnah, Muhammad, through his actions, through his sayings, and through his approval or disapproval, is said to explain or illustrate the Quran for the purposes of life application, for how Muslims should apply the Quran. And all Muslims are expected to carefully follow the example of Muhammad. Now, this is supported in the Quran. There are numerous verses in the Quran that talk about obeying Muhammad and obeying Allah. In Surah 3, in Ayah 31, it says this, "Say, O Muhammad, if you should love Allah, then follow me. So Allah will love you and forgive you of your sins, and Allah is forgiving and merciful." They say, "Obey Allah and the Messenger." But if they turn away, then indeed Allah does not like the disbelievers. In Surah 53, Ayah 2, it says, "Your companion Muhammad has not strayed, nor has he erred, nor does he speak from his own inclination." So much of this Sunnah of Muhammad is contained in collections called Hadith. Contained in collections called Hadith. There are thousands of Hadith. Thousands of them, volumes, many of them disputed. There are arguments over which ones are true, which ones aren't. Some are used by one faction, they're rejected by another. And as you can imagine, Sunnis and Shia both follow different hadith. Some the same, but much different. Hadith have a religious intent. Some are doctrinal, they're for doctrinal instruction regarding practice. And so in the Hadith, you're not going to get as much historical fact as you are just application of the Quran to life, right? So some important facts, dates may be missing. So documents of Sunnah, or the teachings, the example, the approvals of Muhammad, are also supplemented with what's called the Sira of Muhammad, S-I-R-A, the Sira of Muhammad. And these are various biographies of the life of Muhammad. So you have the Quran, you have the Hadith, the teaching, sayings, actions, approvals of Muhammad. And then you have the Sirah, which are biographies of Muhammad, more factually based. And then you have collections of commentaries, like we do for the Bible. Commentaries on the Quran are called Tafsir, T-A-F-S-I-R, Tafsir. So you have the Sunnah, comprised mainly of Hadith. You have the Sirah with the Hadith that elucidate, illustrate the Quran, the practice of Islam, the life of Muhammad, and you have the Tafsir, which seeks to explain it and to apply it. All right. Now that text, talked about the revelation, now let's talk about who it was revealed to, who it was revealed through. The text of the Quran was delivered to Muhammad. Full name, Muhammad ibn Abdallah ibn Abd al-Muttalib. Hard to say. Muhammad is considered to be the last and greatest prophet sent by Allah, and he was sent to restore true Islam. He was born on April 20th. If you're Sunni, if you're Shia, it was April 26th. Anyone in here have an April 20th or April 26th birthday? Okay. Born in April, 570 AD in Mecca. And he was born to a pagan tribe called the Quraysh. After Muhammad was born, his father died soon after. His mom died when he was 6. And so he was raised by his uncle, who was named Abu Talib, his uncle. Now, Muslims believe that Moses predicted the coming of the prophet Muhammad. So recorded in the Hadith, a small group of Muhammad's companions said to him, "O apostle of Allah, tell us about yourself." And he answered them and said that he is the servant of God, the seal of the prophets, the prayer of his forefather Abraham, and the good news of Jesus. That's how Muhammad described himself. In fact, prophecy concerning John the Baptist is redirected to Muhammad. The voice of one crying in the wilderness is Muhammad. The servant in Isaiah, we've looked at those passages many times, right? The servant in Isaiah is said to be Muhammad. Psalm 45 is said to be speaking of Muhammad. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. Scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. That's speaking of Muhammad. Psalm 110, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Speaking of Muhammad. He is the altogether lovely of the Song of Solomon. You know, it's interesting there. Now, this is not without some basis. The word lovely in Hebrew there is machmad. It sounds like Muhammad. And machmad there in Song of Solomon chapter 5 is in the plural, machmadim. And so they say that sounds like Muhammad. So Muhammad is also the Son of Man, prophesied in Daniel chapter 7. Listen to this. Let's turn there together. If you got your Bibles, turn to Deuteronomy chapter 18. Deuteronomy chapter 18. Are you guys hanging in there with me? I know this is a lot of information. Very difficult. I want to give you a good basis, and it's just not sure how else to do this. You're going to get good theology over the next couple of days, but I just want to give you a good groundwork, a good basis to be able to understand what's going to happen in the next sessions that come here. So in Deuteronomy chapter 18, I'll look down at verse 15. Here the Bible says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst, from your brethren, and him you shall hear according to all you desired of the Lord, your God in Horeb in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, nor let me see this great fire any more, lest I die." Look at verse 18. "I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren." Now, who is the brother of Isaac from their perspective? Ishmael. Right, so when it says he's going to raise up a prophet from among their brethren, he's speaking of Ishmael. And here he says, "I'll put my words in his mouth and he'll speak to them all that I command him. It shall be that whoever will not hear my words, which he speaks in my name, I will require it of him." Boy, if you twist the perspective, you can see where they get this, right? Verse 20, "But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I've not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. You say in your heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, the thing does not happen or come to pass. That is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has not spoken it presumptuously. You shall not be afraid of him." So look at that's Deuteronomy chapter 18. That's specifically prophesying the coming of Muhammad. Look at John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Now these are texts that are loosely referred to in the Quran, more specifically referred to in the Hadith, that talk about our Bible prophesying the coming of Muhammad. In John chapter 14, drop down to verse 15. Here John says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." The Lord says, "If you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper." That word there for helper, paraclete, is a reference to Muhammad. "And that helper will abide with you forever." Verse 17, "The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." I'm not sure how they apply all of that, but this is all a reference to Muhammad. "I'll not leave you orphans," verse 18, "I'll come to you." All speaking of Muhammad. Flip the page to John chapter 16 and look at verse 5. Verse 5 says, "But now I go away to him who sent me, and none of you asked me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the helper," again a reference to Muhammad, "will not come to you. But if I depart, I'll send him to you." Again, all this referring to Muhammad. Look at Mark chapter 12. Mark chapter 12. Give you one more example here. And drop down to verse 35. We've looked at this text before, but listen to the perspective that they look at it from. Mark chapter 12, beginning in verse 35. And Jesus answered and said, while he taught in the temple, how is it that the scribes say that the Christ is the son of David? For David himself said by the Holy Spirit, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Now we just illustrated from Psalm 110 that that's referring to Muhammad, right? Verse 37, therefore David himself calls him Lord. How is he then his son? And the common people heard him gladly. Now, in the Quran, there was a priestly Messiah. That was Jesus who came from Mary. That's in the Quran. There was a priestly Messiah. That's Jesus. But there would also be a kingly Messiah. And that kingly Messiah in the Quran would not be from the line of David. It would be from the line of Ishmael. He would come from Ishmael. And so when they read Mark chapter 12, verse 34, they're showing Jesus arguing against the Davidic lineage of this person who's come, which they would refer to as Muhammad. Jesus is asking in the negative, how is it that the scribes say that the Christ is the son of David? In other words, he's not. For David himself said by the Holy Spirit, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, David himself calls him Lord. How is he then his son? In other words, Jesus is here in Mark 12 arguing for Muslims that this is not Jesus, this is Muhammad. He's not from the line of David, even from the line of Ishmael. So in many ways, now if you start putting that together, in many ways, Muhammad is the antichrist of biblical Christianity. He's the anti-spirit of biblical Christianity. The Muslims believe that it is the self-will and ignorant obstinacy of Christians and Jews that they do not see Muhammad's coming in the Bible and profess to follow Islam. And so they reject Muhammad in willful disobedience to Allah. So now let's talk about Muhammad for a moment. Muhammad was a young man. When he was a young man, he worked in trade. Mecca was on a major trade route, and so there were many people that came through Mecca. One of the reasons was a huge pagan influence in Mecca. There was a block, the Kaaba. We recognize that term already, right? The Kaaba was in Mecca, and the Kaaba was a house of pagan idol worship. They had numerous idols set up in the Kaaba. The major one at the time was the god Hubal, but it was a center for pagan worship. And so Muhammad was brought up around this pagan worship, and he had a lucrative business among the pilgrims that came to Mecca to the local shrine to worship their various gods there. Now, important to note that among the pagan idols in Mecca at the Kaaba were three goddesses that are going to be important for later. Many of the tribes in and around the area of Mecca worshipped. They were Alat, Aluza, and Manat. Alat, Aluza, and Manat, three goddesses at the Kaaba. We'll talk about those in a moment. In addition to pagans, you also had Jews and Christians that lived in this area. There were many Jewish and Christian groups of people living in and around Mecca. The Gnostics were there. The Nestorians were there. You know, most of these groups of Jews or Christians were heretical, like grossly heretical. The Gnostics believed that matter was evil, and so God could not come in the form of a man. The Nestorians were there. Very evangelistic Nestorians were. And Jesus was attached to the Son of God who lived in him, but could not be God and man simultaneously. It's called diaphysitism. And monophysites were also there. And those were people that believed that Jesus' human nature was absorbed into his divine nature. In other words, all of these groups denied the Trinity. All of these groups denied either the humanity or the divinity of Christ. They were all heretical. Now, additionally, both in Mecca, where Muhammad started, and in Medina, where he eventually moved, in both cities, there were three powerful Jewish sects or tribes. And with the Jews at this time, much of their teaching came from a book called the Talmud, rabbinic writings, extra-biblical writings. But the teachings from the Talmud were very prevalent among those heretical groups. Abu Talib, Muhammad's uncle, was himself involved with a a ridiculously heretical Christian monk named Bahira in Busra, Syria. His uncle would take him on trips to visit the crazy monk, would take Muhammad with him, and there was access to his teaching. They would be taught, he would teach Muhammad, but it was heretical teaching, rabidly monotheistic with no understanding of true Christian teaching on the Trinity. Eventually, Muhammad was involved with trade to Syria, and he did well in that trade. He's thought of as a good businessman, was thought of as honest and trustworthy. Eventually, being successful in that trade route to Syria, he was hired by an older woman to run her trade business. Her name was Khadija, and she became Muhammad's first wife, Khadija. He was 25, and she was 40. Now, Khadija had a cousin. Her cousin's name was Waraka bin Nafal bin Asad bin Abdul Uzza bin Qazi. Yeah. And he was a convert to Christianity from Judaism. Now, put this together, okay? You've got Muhammad around these heretical Jewish sects, these heretical Christian sects. He's been exposed to Christian heresy, Gnosticism, Nestorianism. He's been exposed to the Talmud, all these various competing influences in Muhammad's life. And then Khadija, he marries Khadija, and Khadija had a cousin very close to named Waraka. Waraka was a convert to Christian, quote-unquote Christianity, right, from Judaism. Now, it was said that Waraka studied the scriptures, and Waraka was looking for the prophet of Deuteronomy 18, was looking for a prophet to arise like one sent from Moses. The Jews of that area, in the area around Mecca, were reported to have boasted against the Arabs there that they too were looking for a prophet to come. Who would be the prophet they would still be waiting for? The Messiah, right? They were still waiting on their Messiah. They didn't accept Jesus Christ as their Messiah. They were still waiting on the Messiah to come. So they were looking for a prophet, and they said to the Arabs that with his help, we're going to kill you. So when he comes, he's going to establish his kingdom on the earth. You guys are going to be done. And so Allah curses these Jews in the Quran, and it's a curse that is still inflaming Islamic Jewish relations today. It's in Surah chapter 2, and I want to read that to you. Surah chapter 2, beginning in verse ayah 87. Listen to this from the Quran. It says, "We indeed gave Moses the book, and we sent messengers after him, one after another, and we gave Jesus, the son of Mary, clear arguments and strengthened him with the Holy Spirit." Interesting. "It is then that whenever there came to you a messenger with what your souls desired not, you were arrogant. And some of you gave the lie to, and others you would slay. And they said, our hearts are repositories. Nay, Allah has cursed them on account of their unbelief. So little it is that they believe. And when they came to them a book from Allah, and when there came to them a book from Allah, verifying that which they have, and aforetime they used to pray for victory against those who disbelieved. But when there came to them that which they recognized, they disbelieved in it. So Allah's curse is on the disbelievers. Evil is that for which they sell their souls. They should deny that which Allah has revealed out of envy that Allah should send down his grace on whomever of his servants he pleases. They incur wrath upon wrath, and there is a humiliating or an abasing chastisement for these unbelievers." So this is a curse that Allah passed down to the Jews after the Jews had sort of excoriated the Arabs at that time. There was this battle that went back and forth. So Allah revealed a curse on the Jews to Muhammad. Now, during his later years, Muhammad became more and more contemplative. As he got older, and this wasn't unusual at the time, there were folks that did this. Muhammad became more and more contemplative, and many would retreat into caves and spend time alone meditating. Aisha, one of Muhammad's later wives, in fact, Aisha was Muhammad's favorite wife. She was 6 when Muhammad married her, and she was 9 when he consummated the marriage. Now, she recorded this: "The commencement of the divine revelation to Allah's messenger was in the form of good, righteous, true dreams, which came true like bright daylight. And then the love of seclusion was bestowed upon him. He used to go in seclusion in the cave of Hira, where he used to worship Allah alone continuously for many days and nights, till suddenly the truth descended upon him while he was in the cave of Hira." Now, at first, when Muhammad went into the cave, and receive the revelation, he couldn't identify the source of the encounter. One Muslim tradition notes that it took 3 years before they finally and confidently identified the angel that gave him the revelation as Gabriel. They thought it was another angel before and finally decided that it was Gabriel. But now this encounter in the cave is recorded in the words of Muhammad in volume 9 of the Bukhari Hadith. So this Hadith that expresses the words, the actions, or the example of the Prophet, the Hadith, the Bukhari Hadith, says this: "The Prophet added, 'The angel caught me forcefully and pressed me so hard that I could not bear it anymore. He then released me and again asked me to read, and I replied, "I do not know how to read." Thereupon, he caught me again and pressed me a second time till I could not bear it anymore. He then released me and asked me again to read, but again I replied, "I do not know how to read, or what shall I read?" Thereupon, he caught me for a third time and pressed me and then released me and said, "Read. In the name of your Lord, who has created all that exists, has created man from a clot, read. And your Lord is most generous unto that which he knew not." Now, Muhammad's first impression of this revelation to him was either that he was crazy or demon-possessed. And he considered suicide as a result several times. The Hadith by Ibn Ishaq reports this: Muhammad said, "I will go to the top of the mountain and throw myself down that I may kill myself and gain rest. So I went forth to do so, and then when I was midday on the mountain, I heard a voice from heaven saying, 'O Muhammad, thou art an apostle of God, and I am Gabriel.' I raised my head toward heaven to see who is speaking, and lo, Gabriel in the form of a man with feet astride the horizon, saying, 'O Muhammad, thou art the apostle of God, and I am Gabriel.'" That was Muhammad's later recollection of this event. In the beginning, Muhammad is reported to have said, "Woe is me, poet or possessed." Now, poet was an evil term, someone who got to them evil visions or evil dreams. They prophesied evil against others. That was a poet. So Muhammad thought that this was evil or that he was demon-possessed when all this happened. So to help, he went to Khadija, told his wife what had happened. And Khadija went to her cousin, Waraka. Waraka was looking for a prophet, and he was this converted Jew to Christianity, heretical Christianity. And so when Khadija went to Waraka and told Waraka what had happened, what did Waraka say? "He's a prophet. He's a prophet. Gabriel's come to visit him." You know, if you think about it now, if it wasn't for Khadija, wasn't for Waraka, we'd probably have no Islam today. Because Muhammad would have thought he was a madman, but they convinced him that he wasn't. Khadija wanted to devise one more test to make sure that this wasn't demon possession or something evil, wanted to devise one more test to prove that this was Allah. And so Khadija set this up. This is from, again, the Bukhari Hadith. "So when Gabriel came to him, as he was wont, the apostle said to Khadija, 'This is Gabriel, who has just come to me.'" Now they're in the cave together, and Gabriel is said to have come to Muhammad. Khadija can't see him, Muhammad can, okay? "So the apostle, Muhammad, said to Khadija, 'This is Gabriel, who has just come to me.' 'Get up, O son of my uncle,' she said, 'and sit by my left thigh.' The apostle did so, and she said, 'Can you see him?' 'Yes,' he said. So Khadija said, 'Then turn around and sit on my right thigh.' He did so, and she said, 'Can you see him?' When he said that he could, she asked him to move and sit in her lap. When he had done this again, she asked again if he could see him. And when he said yes, she disclosed her form and cast aside her veil while the apostle was sitting in her lap. Then she said, 'Can you see him?' And he replied, 'No.' So she said, 'O son of my uncle, rejoice and be of good heart. By God, he is an angel and not Satan.'" And do you get the test? When she disclosed her form, when she took off her veil, the angel departed. So that's why even to this day, you've got hardline Muslims who would say that a woman should be veiled, because it is so sinful to look upon an unveiled woman that even angels flee. And this sort of act of purity on the part of this angel proved that he was Gabriel and not Satan. So he passes the test, and Muhammad becomes more and more convinced over time that the revelation that he's getting is revelation that's coming from the angel Gabriel, from Allah himself. But every time, now after this, shortly after this, Waraka dies. So you have this influence of Waraka, and it's a reassuring influence. Waraka dies, and so Muhammad falls into despair again, and Muhammad is seeking to kill himself. But every time he goes up to the mountain to throw himself off, Gabriel appears to him again. Now, who would we equate Gabriel with? That's right. It's not far-fetched to think that messengers of God come disguised as angels of light, right? Others, however, although Muhammad became more convinced, although Khadija and Waraka were both very convinced, others for a long time did not believe him. There's much more that could be said about this revelation. We'll get into that some, I think, as the days go by. Now, if Allah had anything to do with the actual Bible, you would expect that Muhammad would quote more from the actual Bible and less from extra-biblical documents known as the Talmud. But much of what Muhammad quotes as biblical actually comes from the Talmud and not from the Bible. Now, that would be the case if Muhammad was around Jewish sects and Christian heretics. It would not be the case if he was getting revelation directly from Allah, right? But Muhammad was around people that got their teaching from the Talmud. There's a story, obviously the story of Cain and Abel in the Bible, right? Cain and Abel in the Bible, we're familiar with that story. In the Talmud, there's a story, a legend, about Cain and Abel, where in order to teach Cain what he should do with Abel's body after he killed him, a raven comes and scratches on the ground. In other words, Cain, you need to bury your brother Abel. And that's Talmudic legend. It's in the Talmud. The Quran, in recording this same account of Cain and Abel, records that a raven came to Cain to show him what to do with the body of his brother Abel. So it came straight out of the Talmud, right? In addition to this kind of thing, those things are throughout the Quran. You have also what are called revelations of convenience. Revelations of convenience. Whenever Muhammad wanted something, he got a revelation from God that allowed him to have it. There were certain instances of this, revelations of convenience. One example is an example of Zainab and Zayd. Zainab was the wife of Muhammad's adopted son, Zayd, Zayd bin Haritha. Notice it's not Zayd bin Muhammad. It was an adopted son. Originally, as an adopted son, Zayd bin Muhammad. But he's recorded as Zayd bin Haritha. I'll tell you why in a moment. This was an unwanted marriage. Zayd did not want to marry Zainab, but Muhammad desired Zainab. It was said in the hadith that Muhammad went to Zayd's house. Zayd wasn't there. And when he went in, saw Zainab and looked on her with favor. Zainab was apparently a very, very beautiful woman. And so Muhammad desires Zainab, but she's married to Zayd. Zayd, not wanting the marriage in the first place, and now seeing a way out, goes to Muhammad and suggests that he divorce Zainab so that Muhammad can have her. And so initially Muhammad resists that, tells Zayd to go back to his wife, but eventually Zayd divorces her anyway, and upon his divorce to Zainab, Muhammad tells them to go tell Zainab now that she's my new wife. So they go to Zainab. Zainab becomes Muhammad's wife. Then Muhammad gets a revelation from Allah scolding him for worrying about what people will think about this. They shouldn't worry about what people think. He's the prophet, and he can marry whom he wishes. So to stop worrying about what people might think if he married her, and this, I want you to see this, this revelation of convenience destroys the concept of adoption in Islam. To justify Muhammad's action, the Quran states from a later revelation, Surah 33:5, that wives whom you divorce cannot become your mother, nor has he made adopted sons your sons, they will be called by the names of their father. Now it's something really unusual that Allah would say anything about that particular situation anyway. But here, after this whole event has taken place, if Muhammad marries Zainab, the wife of his son, his adopted son, then Zainab, his former wife, becomes his mother. Allah said you can't do that. And the way out of doing that is that Zayd bin Muhammad is not Zayd bin Muhammad anymore. He should be called Zayd bin Haritha by his biological father's name, so that doesn't happen. So now what that effectively does is it destroys adoption in Islam. You know, we think about in Roman culture, when you adopted someone, adopted a son, adopted a daughter, they became your, as much as a biological son, a biological daughter, they became inheritors of your family, adopted into the family. We think about Christian adoption and what it means that united with Christ, we are adopted into the family of God. What a beautiful truth that is. But in Islam, no longer the case. Another revelation of convenience. Move along here. Another revelation of convenience. Aisha, his favorite wife, is accused of immorality. Aisha was stranded one time, spent time alone with a man who was not her husband after Muhammad had given the rule that all women should be veiled. And so accusations started flying, slander started flying. Aisha's not allowed to have a voice in any of this at all. Finally, a revelation comes from Allah exonerating Aisha for this indiscretion, so to speak. And here's where this has impact. Aisha was accused of sexual immorality with a man who was not her husband when she was caught alone on a trail. They were on their way to the battle, and Aisha got stranded with another man. It says in the Quran then, in order to, as a result of this whole thing, this revelation that Muhammad got, in order to exonerate Aisha, Allah reveals to Muhammad, did they come with four witnesses, four male witnesses of the indiscretion? They didn't. And so Allah, through Gabriel, says to Muhammad, they're liars, not to believe their slander, not to believe their accusation. So it lets Aisha off the hook. But what it also does is set up the rule in Sharia law that in order to accuse, for a woman to say, I've been raped, she has absolutely no voice in the accusation. Her word is not admissible in court. And it takes four male witnesses to say that she was raped. And so what it's done in Islamic culture and in a lot of Muslim countries is it's created a culture where sexual immorality is largely overlooked or accepted because they can't do anything about it. Not only that, but if the woman doesn't have four male witnesses to testify that she's been raped, let's say it's three or two, then her accusation of rape turns into a confession of adultery. And it said there's a report, see if I can find that for you, April 6, 2000 report from the Sisters of Islam, that as many as 75% of women in prison under Sharia law in Pakistan are there for the crime of being victims of rape. There was one high-profile report, and I remember this in the news, January 2002, in Nigeria, where a woman, in the news, facing execution for adultery because they could not find the requisite four male witnesses to support her accusation of rape, and her accusation of rape became a confession of adultery. So we'll talk more about that when we address Sharia law tomorrow. Regarding the revelation here, there's also a very controversial account referenced by Ibn Ishaq, and even in the Quran, in Surah 53, concerning what are called the Satanic Verses. Have you ever heard of that book by Salman Rushdie, the Satanic Verses? There was a fatwa issued against Salman Rushdie. They haven't killed because of this. But the Satanic Verses, there was actually another revelation of convenience. Muhammad had been exasperated, trying to convert people in the Quraysh tribe around his home in Mecca. Couldn't get it done. They wouldn't listen to him, right? They thought he was a fraud, couldn't convert them to Islam. So he became more and more hostile against them. Finally, they got tired of his rants against him. He wasn't making any progress with them, so they came to him with a deal. They said, listen, Muhammad, if you'll bow down and worship our three goddesses, right? Alat, Al-Azza, and Manat. If you'll worship them for a year, we'll worship Allah for a year. So Muhammad went back, let me consult Allah and Gabriel, and came back and said, it's a good idea, let's do it. Everybody went away happy. So now you have Muhammad, the prophet, getting direct revelation from Gabriel, from Allah, saying, who is fiercely monotheistic, and it's shirk to be polytheistic, Allah gave me approval to worship for a year, Alat, Al-Azza, and Manat. And they were going to worship Allah for a year. Well, as it turns out, in another revelation of convenience, Allah comes back and says that it wasn't Gabriel that put those words into Muhammad's mouth. It was Satan. And so they're called the Satanic Verses. And basically, Gabriel said, what are you thinking? You're crazy. You're not allowed to do that. That was Satan who revealed that to you. Then now think about it for a moment. There's surah in the Quran that teach against this. If the words of Satan can come out of Muhammad's mouth as easily as the words of Allah can come out of Muhammad, how can you trust any of it, right? These are the satanic verses. He initially refused, and then he received a revelation that it was okay. Surah 22 says this, "We did not send before you any messenger or prophet except that when he spoke or recited, Satan threw into it some misunderstanding. But Allah abolishes that which Satan throws in, then Allah makes precise his verses, and Allah is knowing and wise. That is, so that he may make what Satan throws in a trial for those within whose hearts is disease and those hard of heart. And indeed, the wrongdoers are in extreme dissension." That's in Surah 22 in the Quran. Muhammad is called the perfect man, Al-Insan, Al-Kamil, the perfect man. He's listed or held up as the supreme example of behavior for Muslims to follow. They say that he is an excellent model of conduct. In the Quran, certainly you have in the Messenger of Allah an excellent exemplar for him who hopes in Allah and the latter day and remembers Allah much. He's held up as a standard of excellent character, an exalted standard. So no matter how you stretch it, it's glaringly obvious, right, that Muhammad is no Jesus Christ. No credible person could ever argue that Jesus Christ taught violence. In fact, the Lord said, those who live by the sword will die by the sword. Right? Turn the other cheek. Love your enemies. The Lord Jesus Christ came to lay down his life for the sheep. The Lord Jesus Christ wept over them in prayer. He shed his own blood for them rather than shedding the blood of others for himself. He was merciful to the woman who was caught in adultery against those who wanted to have her stoned. In Islam, there's no adoption. What a glorious truth, right? Biblical truth, adoption. In Islam, no communion with the Father, no relationship. God isn't dwelling with his people. He certainly isn't indwelling them. There's no bride-groom relationship. Essentially, there's no church in that sense. There's no personal, intimate revelation of himself to believers where he calls them by name, right? Washes them, makes them his prized possession, the apple of his eye. No real forgiveness. He doesn't sanctify them and wash them and eventually glorify them. And the more that we study this, and the more that you look at this, the more that we love the Bible and love the Lord Jesus Christ, grateful for the truth that God has revealed in his word, and the more that we should have a burden on our hearts for Muslims who are in darkness, enslaved in this false religion. So let's pray. Thank you, guys. You've been troopers. I was about to ask somebody to take the batteries out of the clock back there. didn't want to look at it anymore. But that was a lot of information. Now, what I hope, and thank you guys for hanging in there with me through that. That was probably a little painful, probably more than a little painful. Is that take the notes that you've got. I saw many of you taking good notes. Review some of that. Think through some of those critical issues, those critical points. Because they're going to come in handy as you listen to the other brothers as they give their sessions. There's going to be much that will be spoken about, and that foundation will help you. And then use that as a resource for the future, too, as you witness to Muslims. Hopefully that was helpful. All right, well, let's pray, get you home, and we'll see you back in the morning. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for our time together. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy to us. Lord, you are so good, so gracious. We are so grateful to you, Lord, for the truth as it has been revealed to us in Christ, your word. We praise you, Lord, for your mercy to us in that. And Lord, help us now as we think through these things. Lord, help us to be able to process through this counterfeit that Satan has erected, that has enslaved people in darkness. And help us, Lord, in faithfulness to you, being witnesses of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as you gather your elect in from the four corners of this world, from every tribe, tongue, and nation. Lord, help us with the testimony of Christ on our heart, on our lips, to be able to go to people enslaved in this false religion and to share with them the truth as it is in Christ, a truth revealed in your word, for their soul's sake, Lord, that they might be saved, and for your eternal praise and worship. We pray all these things for your glory. We pray them in the blessed name of our great God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, we'll see you guys in the morning. Thank you. Have a good night.